And thank you all for coming to this lecture recital. It's my first such event with the Hartford Music Society, and it's great to see some familiar faces alongside some other newer ones. And so, as you might have seen, I've chosen to explore the topic of pilgrimages in this mini lecture recital. And a lot of you may be wondering what in the world does that mean, musical pilgrimage or pilgrimages? And first of all, I'd like to reassure you and say that that's not a concept of sacred music. I'm very well aware of all the choral singing that's going on in Oxford, and they're doing an excellent job at it. And I think we've all got our fair share of Christmas caroling anyway. So it's not pilgrimages in the religious sense of the term, but rather in a broader and oftentimes more metaphorical. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about and perform works for piano from the 20th century piano as well, that have to do with the broad sense of pilgrimages, whether in a visual sense or in a more symbolic meaning. Of course, I'm going to speak about the great 19th century composer and virtuoso Franz Liszt and of his Année de Pèlerinage, or Years of Pilgrimage, that is his famous piano cycle, three parts inspired by his travels across Europe. So here we've got the spiritual, soul-searching pilgrimage in the most romantic sense of the term. But I'm also going to speak of... Hi! I'm also going to speak of another type of Listian pilgrimage, and that is his tribute or his homage to the opera composer Richard Wagner through his piano transcriptions of the latter's work. First, however, I'm going to start with a more metaphorical exploration of this idea of pilgrimage, with this beautiful cycle by Czech composer Leos Janáček that's called On the Overgrown Path. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the work of Janáček, but this cycle is among his most famous and often performed works, alongside his operas, obviously. And it was composed in the early years of the 20th century. And here the title is of the utmost significance, as Janáček takes us on this journey, on this pilgrimage, one might say, on precisely the overgrown path of memory and the sort of bittersweet remembrance of the nostalgia. It's a musical trip down memory lane, so to speak, and that's what kind of relates it to this idea of pilgrimage. You'll find that pieces from the first part of the cycle are quite, I should say, light-hearted, quaint, very entertaining, as you will hear, and also sort of childlike and naive in many ways, in their evocation of childhood memories, Czech folklore, descriptions of nature, scenes of country life. I think we're all going to enjoy this very cute side of this musical cycle. But what I want to talk about is something that goes beyond the quaint aspect of this music, and it's the fact that the cycle displays one of the key aspects of Janáček's musical style, and that is his fascination with the rhythms and inflections of spoken language, of human speech. That was more than a fascination. It was probably an obsession throughout Janáček's life, as his contemporary recalled the way he was always stopwatch in hand in various situations of daily life, trying to catch glimpses of what people were saying all around him and jot them down in musical notation in his notebooks, only to integrate them in his musical works. And so this is an aspect that's present throughout Janáček's work, but more particularly in this cycle, which virtually swarms with those eruptions of speech in music. A very good example is piece number 5, which very appropriately is called They Chattered Like Swallows. Now obviously there's the humorous, comical elements to it. And here Janáček represents a conversation between two characters restlessly chattering, represented by two musical lines in a very close imitative fidelity. That's keep tossing back and forth the same little musical motif, one upping each other, interrupting each other in sort of very vivid dialogue. So this conversation between the two hands of the pianist goes as follows. Now, as you notice, there's obviously the humorous element to it, and I hope you'll pay attention later on during the piece when you play it, that moment where the two voices, the two characters, go slightly out of sync and slowing down as if starting to actually listen to what the other is saying. Now, that is this language, the speech-like element, those hints of patter songs, speech-like melodies and rhythms are one of the things that make this music so vivid and expressive. And another element that makes it so rich and appealing is what we call tone painting, or as some of my musicology students might know, is the art of conveying images and landscapes through solely musical means. Again, lots of descriptions of nature throughout the cycle, but perhaps the most interesting piece in this regard is piece number 4, especially as it depicts an actual pilgrimage in the literal sense of the term, which is, after all, our theme for today. Piece number 4 is called the Madonna of Friedeck, or Our Lady of Friedeck. That is a church and a monastery in the Czech countryside that sits atop a hill. And it is precisely a favorite destination for local pilgrims and believers who at certain times of the year organize processions and go on a pilgrimage precisely to the monastery of Friedeck. And now the way Janáček chooses to represent this in music is that he quotes a pilgrim's chant, a pilgrim's melody that he heard on such occasions at the Friedeck Monastery, which is the following. What's brilliant is the way Janáček anchors this pilgrim's melody in the landscape by accompanying it with the rumbling, the murmurs of bells echoing in the distance. Now notice how those long sustained bells and those rumbling figures of the bells in the distance convey the sense of space, this almost physical sense of distance and resonance, further accentuated by the slightly dissonant interval of a major second hidden within the chord that provokes this sort of buzzing, further enhancing the effect of harmonic resonance and distance. And this is why this piece is quite immersive, and I think we're all going to enjoy this description of landscape through music. And actually, the composer indicates with a lot of precision in the score the moments where the pilgrim's melody grows fainter, where it grows a little bit louder, where, so to speak, the pilgrims are a little bit further, when they come closer, as if really we were following with our mind's eye this procession, journeying through the landscape, and closer, going a little bit further, and this adds to the visual appeal of this piece. Now, the cycle has also a darker, more grave and serious aspect to it, especially in the second part, as most of those pieces were composed after a personal tragedy that struck the composer, that is, the death of his only daughter, Olga, at the age of 21. And as you'll notice in the titles you've got in your program leaflets, that's where the themes change to a more somber mood. It's truly, I think, the point in the cycle where nostalgia turns to grief and mourning. Now, this is especially the case of the closing piece of the cycle, which is called The Barn Owl Has Not Flown Away. A very enigmatic ending to this cycle. Janáček speaks of this image as an omen of death, a symbol of mourning, which he experienced at this time of his life. The piece opens with a panicked flutter of wings, followed by the mournful hooting of the owls in the distance. motif is truly ubiquitous throughout the whole piece. It recurs many times. It haunts the piece and alternates with more consoling, chorale-like passages. But the piece and the cycle with it ends on a sort of musical question. Here again, we hear the tolling of the bells that close the cycle. But this time, it is a funeral bell tolling in the distance. And it is truly a sort of a musical question mark, an open-ended question that is, I think, a fitting conclusion to a cycle that unfolds as a meditation on memory, childhood, and grief. Now, bearing all this in mind, and without further ado, I suggest that we embark with Janáček on this journey on the overgrown path of memory.
Thank you. Thank you.
pilgrimage, so to speak, with the great 19th century pianist and composer Franz Liszt. Between 1837 and 1839, Liszt embarked on a long journey across Europe, journeying through France, Switzerland, and finally Italy. This pilgrimage, of sorts, inspired him in composing his famous Année de pèlerinage, or Years of Pilgrimage. That is his monumental piano cycle in three parts that remains one of the summits of piano literature. It is, of course, first of all, a sort of travelogue in which Liszt evokes the scenes he's witnessed, the countries he's traveled in, the landscapes he observed. But much more than this, it is the occasion for Liszt to give free rein to his passion for literature and poetry. In the second volume, dedicated to Italy in particular, Liszt evokes two great medieval poets of Italian literature. Of course, Liszt evokes the great Dante and his Divine Comedy in a monumental piece called A Plain Lecture of the Dante, or After Reading Dante, which is a sort of pianistic inferno for pianists and audiences, which I shall spare you today. On the other hand, however, Liszt pays tribute to Francesco Petrarca. Petrarca is famously known for his sonnets, his love sonnets reunited in his famous Canzoniere. And those poems are a fascinating example, albeit a late one, of the tradition of medieval courtly love. So Liszt composed three musical pieces in the Année de pèlerinage, inspired by three poems by Dante. And the second one of the series, which is the one I'm going to play, is a particularly compelling example, as Liszt indulges in a sort of anachronism, in the sense that he takes this archaic courtly love poem and turns it into a sort of opera aria in the purest Italian bel canto sense of the term. For instance, the opening of the piece is quite evocative in this regard. It is, one might call it, a sort of recitativo accompagnato, an embodied orchestral outburst that opens a scene or aria. It evokes the first verse of Petrarca's poem, which is number 104. That is, non trovo pace e non da far guerra, meaning, I cannot find peace, yet I have no war to fight. So this pseudo recitativo accompagnato evokes the tormented, conflicted opening words of the poem. Now this is followed by a typically more subdued, more restrained opera, which is a spoken-like melody, a sort of vocal declamation that introduces the main theme of the piece. Sensual opera aria repeat with its fioriture or those bel canto vocal ornamentations. Now I've included the poem in your program reference without going into the intricacies of Liszt's text setting. I think this is going to help our imagination soar, and it's going to give you an idea of how Petrarca's tormented, conflicted poetry lends itself to such a dramatic or almost operatic treatment. And now, without further ado, I suggest we bear all this in mind and delve into this beautiful rendition in music of Petrarca's Sonnet 104 in Liszt's Année de Pèlerinage.
Thank you.
one stop on our journey, so to speak, with another type of Lestian pilgrimage. And I'm speaking, of course, of his tribute or his homage to the great opera composer Richard Wagner, who was Liszt's close friend and associate, and later on son-in-law. There are truly many ways in which Liszt contributed to Wagner's fame and to Wagner's career and life during their respective lifetimes. But I think that one of Liszt's most enduring tributes to Wagner was his series of transcriptions for piano of scenes from Wagner's operas. And a particularly interesting case is Liszt's transcription of the final scene to Tristan und Isolde, one of Wagner's great hits, so to speak. Tristan und Isolde is based on the medieval legend, the same name as we know, and without spoiling those, spoiling the entire opera to you, I highly recommend that you delve into those five hours of sublime music drama. But suffice to say that this final scene is the moment where Isolde is finally able to reunite with her lover Tristan when she dies. Now, obviously, we're at the opera, and this is a particularly ecstatic or transcendent moment at it, which, in any case, Wagner called Isolde's Verklärung, or Isolde's transfiguration, as it is the moment where she fuses with Tristan beyond life itself. And it is only Liszt, precisely in this transcription, who coined the term Isolde's Liebstod, which is much more in use today, that is, Isolde's love death. And this testifies to the enduring impact of Liszt's transcription work. Now, when it comes to Wagner and Tristan und Isolde, truly, I think there would be thousands of things that I'd like to say, and I think we'd stay here together overnight discussing Wagner, or you'd have to read my PhD dissertation. I don't know which option is worse, but this is why I'm choosing to stop there, and for a change, to let music speak for itself. Now, I think my colleagues will agree, when a musicologist decides to stop speaking, or rather to actually shut up, then, you know, you're about to be confronted to one of the most sublime passages in all of music. And now let us conclude with Liszt's marvelous transcription of the final scene to Richard Wagner's Tristan und Isolde.